y'all doing all right? Good. All right, Anya. We got this. Here we go.
With tears running down your face.
All right.
I'm just like you. Hey, you cut me, I'm gon' bleed.
Gon' bleed.
I want just as well as I got needs. I've been hungry and not had no food to eat. I've been knocked down as soon as I got on my feet.
Lord, it was you
that helped me understand. And it was you that never let go of my hand.
I'm so grateful to God for allowing us to be here today. We didn't have to be. There are thousands and even millions who started out with us last week this time who didn't make it this far, but God has blessed us and given us the opportunity to be here, and I'm glad about it. Amen. We thank God. A couple of announcements before we have our prayer. Welcome to Kyrie Edwards. Amen. Amen. Breast cancer awareness. We got this pink on and gray on, and I think it's just pink, though. I think the gray came in, by the way, but this is breast cancer awareness. Some of us are wearing, I see we got the little ribbons on and all those kind of things to be aware. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Right, men can get it too.
And that statistics say that the higher level of men getting breast cancer, and so they need to do their self-exams also.
Okay, so men can get it too, so you need to do a self-exam and keep up with that, especially as you get past 21. And then you don't have as many of the muscles that, amen. So Men's Day coming up. Reserve your position for the breakfast. Today is the last day. So we're meeting at 10 o'clock at SIU for our breakfast on the 30th. On the 30th. So if you haven't reserved your position, then there won't be no, I'm not giving you any of my bacon. I'm not giving you any of my eggs. So please reserve a position for your own. I saw Brother Cunningham here, so you can talk to him about that if you have a question. Harvest Homecoming, the following weekend, reserve your position for Saturday, November the 6th. So it's November the 6th and November the 7th. I think it's 12 to 2, 11 to 2 on November the 6th, and then the regular worship time on that Sunday. Amen. Happy birthday. Brother Macon, he's in the desert in Texas right now, but his birthday is today. My wife's birthday is coming up Tuesday, and I know Sheila's birthday is coming up
Tuesday.
All right, so we got the October birthdays coming up, so we want to wish happy birthday to. Amen, amen, amen. So a lot going on. Now it's time for us, you know, we come in, and I want to compliment these beautiful young ladies who have been having fun and praising God, and we want to join them, but it's time to touch base with God.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if you've already touched base with him. I'm glad to see Brother Clee back there today. God bless you. We're praying for him, and there are many on our special prayer list. I lost my great aunt. Well, she's really my cousin, but I've always called her auntie, and we had a funeral last Sunday evening, and there have been many situations like that that we've had to say goodbye to our loved ones, and even after that day passes, that hurt doesn't go away that fast. In fact, it can linger on for weeks and months and years sometimes. So we pray for those who've lost loved ones. And we pray for those who are sick right now. This community lost a young lady, and we want to pray for that family. And I think that's the third daughter. You know, but it's only God's grace that allowed us to be here. I see Jackie there, and I know she lost her grandmother, our good friend, and it's been a while, but we forget about it because a couple of days passed, but those who are close don't forget that easy. So let's keep praying for them and encouraging them. Father God, we come today in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, for your grace and for your mercy that allowed us to be here. We thank you, Father, for all the many blessings that we've already received, dear Lord, and some consumed. We thank you, Father, for just being God and God by yourself, for forgiving us for our transgressions, for protecting us, dear Lord, when we could not protect ourselves, for helping us get up when we've fallen down, for being our friend when no one else wanted to be bothered. We give you honor and praise and glory. And Lord, we worship you the best that we know how. Lord, I thank you for those who've joined us today, for those who sing praises, for those who pray prayers, for those who encourage and just give what we, for the greetings we're able to give each other right now. Lord, we thank you. Father, we realize that if it wasn't for your grace and your mercy, none of that could be. We pray for our homes and our families, dear Lord. We pray for all the dysfunction in our nation right now, for our state, Father, for our country, for those people, dear Lord, that we've elected to look out for us that are looking out for someone else. Give us strength, dear Lord, to stay the course. Bless those who have been sick, Lord. I thank you, Father, for those who have been sick that are better now. I thank you for those, dear Lord, who have been down that you've allowed to get up. Many of us have suffered, dear Lord, under the hands of a virus, dear Lord, but you've allowed us, and many didn't make it, but it allowed us to make it through that. There are other things that are wrong in our states and our families and our cities. We have loved ones, dear Lord, that are in trouble, that we're concerned about. We have children, dear Lord, that have grown up, dear Lord, and all they are grown, dear Lord, they're still our children. Bless them, we pray. Bless our elders, dear Lord. As we get older, dear Lord, we approach that childhood stage again sometime. Lord, bless them and help us to have the patience to be a blessing to them also. And Lord, we don't know how to be a church if you don't show us. Speak to our hearts. Guide our words and our actions that we might be a blessing to those around us. Bless this time that we come together, dear Lord, that someone who's come in down might leave up, that someone who came in burdened might leave free of those burdens, that your word might go forth in power, dear Lord, that it may bless your people. And Lord, we're not calling all the names. We're not listing all of the ailments or all the problems, but we ask your blessings. Bereaved families, dear Lord, who lost loved ones, bless them, we pray. Those who are in danger right now, have mercy. Some of us, Lord, have things wrong with us and we don't know what they are. We surrender ourselves before you, Lord, and put ourselves at your... And Father, we belong to you, and we know that because we belong to you, you belong to us. Remember those, Lord, that we might forget today. And bless those, dear Lord, that we can't reach. We thank you for it and we praise you for it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank God.
Amen. We're going to sing a song that is a beautiful song. And the name of it is Thy Will Be Done, which is one of the hardest prayers, I think, that you can pray. Thy will be done because of the free will that we have. Right? So many bad things happen. You're like, Lord, I really don't want that to happen. Can you make it be this way? But God sees everything, and he's looking out ahead, and we have to be able to come to a point that we say, Thy will be done.
Somehow I ended is hurt in these four words. Thy will be done. Thy will be done. Thy will be done.
I know you're good.
Thank you.
Wow, wow. We ought to practice saying that. Thy will be done. I am so excited today about being in the house of God. We got a chance to speak at our home church at Southern Baptist last Sunday. We thankful to Minister Anye for covering for us. Pray for her. Pray for her. We need to get these next generations, and God has called us to nurture them. Amen. Call us to scoot over and make a place for them. Call us to counsel them and to disciple them. And we need to be faithful to that. But I just thank God for Sister Anye and for her. She's been a great help already. And God said something to me, and this is not part of the sermon. In my quiet time with him, he said that we are not just, underline just, we're not just called to be blessed. Now, we're called to be blessed, but we're not just called to be blessed. We're also called to bless. And a lot of us, and nobody minds being blessed. Anybody here mind being blessed? And we ought not mind blessing. If we enjoy and get something good out of being blessed, then we are to joy. You know, you can get more out of blessing than you can from being blessed. Right. I don't know who that's for, but I'm just sharing. You may hear it again. It's kind of like it's about us, but not just about us. And it's kind of in the same vein as that, but we're not just saved and called to be blessed. We're saved and called to bless. And we ought to spend as much time thinking about blessing as we think about being blessed. I'm going to say it one more time. We ought to spend just as much time studying and thinking about blessing as we do studying and thinking about being blessed. Amen, amen, amen. John chapter 11. It's kind of a familiar. Now, I'm invite you when you get home to read the whole chapter 1 through 44. I'm not going to read all of that today. I'm going to read 1 through 8, and I'm going to read 17 through 23 for time's sake. But everybody hear me? Okay. Would you honor God's word with me by standing? I'm going to read 1 through 8, then I'm going to drop down to verse 17 and read 17 through 23. And you can read with me if you like. It says, "Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore, the sisters sent to him, saying, 'Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick.' When Jesus heard that, he said, 'This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it.' Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, 'Let us go to Judea again.' The disciples said to him, 'Rabbi, lately the Jews sought to stone you, and you are going there again?' Now we're going to drop down. I know some other stuff, but for time's sake, to verse 17 says, so when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb for 4 days, talking about Lazarus. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had joined the women around Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, underline even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? May God bless the reading and the hearing of the word. I know it's a lot, but I needed to, you know, I don't want you to think I'm making stuff up. I want to talk for a few minutes to you from the subject, even now. And if you want a better, it's never too late for God. Even now, it's never too late for God. And we're living in and hopefully living through a time that is unlike any other time that I have seen in my lifetime. I've never experienced so many deaths as we have seen in the last 18 months. I guess almost 2 years now. I read about some stuff in the history books that happened in the early century before, but I've never seen a time when so many young and old have fallen prey to a disease or a sickness, and it's taken them out. Just in the last week or so, there was a citywide prayer vigil for one of the young ladies in our town who was battling that Delta variant of the coronavirus. But in spite of all the petitions sent up before God, it wasn't a full week before she died. I mentioned earlier last Sunday evening we had to say goodbye to my auntie, my mother's best friend, who served for over 50 years as a mother for me. And maybe you're faring well in this pandemic, but these are perilous times to me. And we're having a difficult time escaping. We thought they were over last June, and then they crept back up. I never acknowledged this before, but it seems like even the prayer of the righteous is not doing much good in many cases right now. I know that this is not for everyone, but I've come to talk to some people who prayed as hard as they knew how to pray. I want to talk to some folk who have asked God to come in and make a difference in their situation. I want to talk to someone who has asked God to heal their loved one, who has asked God to let them keep their job, who has asked God to spare their child, who has asked God to stop something bad from happening in their life, but in spite of all their prayer, in spite of their sincere petitions to the throne of God, in spite of how hard they begged God, their request was not honored. The loved one died anyway. They lost a job that they were trying to keep. Their child continued to go through what they were going through. That bad thing that was hanging over their head happened. So your prayer wasn't answered in the affirmative, yet so what do you do? When I was young, I couldn't preach this. What do you do when God doesn't satisfactorily answer your prayer? How do you act when you feel like God has let you down? That's the picture that we're looking at in our text today. Caution. It takes some moxie to open this door. This may hurt. But I guarantee you, if you listen, and it'll help. I hope it's okay if we go there. John is the only gospel writer with the nerve enough to share this story. You won't find it in Matthew, Mark, Luke. And I think the reason is that the relationship John had with Jesus was different. It was special compared to the other disciples' relationship. It seems like John knew Jesus on a level more personal than the other guys. And that's why John could write in this gospel about Jesus as a man and how he felt about personal stuff. And in this passage, we actually see Jesus' hurt. In the beginning of this chapter, John lets us know that a certain man was sick. Oftentimes, the Lord uses a parable about someone to teach us something, but this is not a parable about a man that we don't know. This is a real story about somebody we've heard of. It's a true story about a real man. And this is a real and a specific, let's call it a case study. This is about people that we have heard about before who were close to Jesus. The incident takes place in Bethany, and the star character is Lazarus of Bethany, the town where Mary and her sister Mary lived. And most of you have already heard about Martha and Mary. You remember them. You remember the two sisters who were entertaining Jesus, and the one sister was working like a Hebrew slave, and the other sister was sitting down at his feet just soaking it in. And she asked Jesus to make her sister come help her. And this was the same Mary who anointed the Lord's feet with perfume and dried them with her hair. That's the family we're talking about, though. It was their brother, Lazarus, who was sick. He's a certain man. And note that these were the people who made a habit of giving Jesus a place to stop and relax whenever he came to town. These were the people who fed him and cared for him every time he showed up. I remember how my grandmother used to invite the pastor over for dinner every Sunday. She would give him the first and the best of everything. No wonder he traveled all the way back from Detroit to officiate her funeral. John makes it a point here to tell us that Jesus loved Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, their brother. And we all know that as the Son of God, Jesus loved people. He loved everybody. He loved all of us. He died for all of us. But this is obviously a little different. You understand that when someone blesses you on a continuous basis, the way Mary and Martha bless Jesus, they can't help but become special. Doesn't mean that he didn't love us. But Mary and Martha and Lazarus were special. You know, I truly love every member of Mount Joy Church. I would do anything within my power to bless any member that we have here. But I got to admit that there are some people who go out of their way to be a blessing to my family and I on a consistent basis. Well, to be truthful, kids are really my special. I mean, I love all the kids. I tolerate the adult, but I love the kids. But other than that, I try not to have favorites, but some people make themselves special to you because of how consistently they love you. That doesn't take away from your love for others. but it does make you special. Jesus especially loved Mary and Martha and Lazarus because of the blessing they were to him. It's like John, our writer, who called himself the disciple that Jesus loved. Now nobody else called John that but John. But he knew that Christ loved him because he loved Christ. He's the one leaning on his shoulder and asking him questions and stuff. So he was special. They didn't have cell phones or text messaging back in these days, but these sisters, when their brother got sick, sent a messenger out, and likely a young runner who could run all the way to where he was, you know, so they sent this messenger to Jesus saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. We need you. And they probably hadn't asked Christ for anything to that date. And perhaps the thing that stood out in this passage the most when I first read it was how Jesus responded. Let me read 5 and 6 again. Now when Jesus loved, it says, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And the 6 says, so when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. It sounded like an emergency to me, didn't it? But Jesus blew it off. He didn't respond with the urgency that, in my mind, that the message seemed to call for. Listen to what he said. This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Jesus stayed where he was for 2 more days, in spite of knowing that his friend was sick. And when Jesus finally decided that it was time to go and see about Lazarus, his disciples reminded him, you know, they tried to stone you when you were there last time. Think about that. But that wasn't a factor. So I've studied this passage before. I preached this passage before, but I see some stuff now that I didn't see before. There's so much here that it would take a 4 or 5 sermon deal to cover it all, but let's drop down for time's sake to verse 17, where Jesus, he arrives in Bethany. And the Bible said that Bethany is about 2 miles from Jerusalem, so close. But by the time Jesus arrives, Lazarus has been dead and in the tomb for 4 days. Now, that part of the country is kind of hot. Now, when I calculate the travel time based on what we're given, he couldn't have gotten there before Lazarus died anyway, if he had left right away, but that's not the point. He took 2 days for the runner to get there to him. So it probably took 2 days for the runner to get back. You see, and he couldn't go as fast as the runner, but so 3 or 4 days at least. The point is, Lazarus would have still died before Jesus arrived.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's a story for another sermon. Let's just say that the fact that when Jesus arrived, it was too late to keep him from dying. And in that climate, 4 days, he was already, what they say, cutting up. His body was already breaking down. It had started to decay already. And by all accounts, the time when Jesus could have done something had come and gone. And in the eyes of everyone involved, it was just too late now for him to help. You ever call somebody and they got there too late? The crisis was over now. Death had already come and Lazarus was already long gone. It was now time to move on. We don't like to say this, but in the eyes of many, Jesus had let his special friends down. You ever felt like God has let you down? Like I say, I'm trying to focus, because you know what? This is a message that we don't want to think about. But this is a strange to me, because Jesus had, he had been known to heal people from long distance without traveling where he was. You've heard about the servant of the military leader who said, you know what, Lord, don't even come to my house, just say the word. You heard about the guy whose daughter was sick, and he said, when you get home, your daughter will be well. So Jesus had overcome distance before and helped people before, but in this situation, when the people were special to him, nothing was done to stop Lazarus from dying. Now, even the opportunity to help was gone. Lazarus' sickness turned into death, and in spite of how close he and his sisters were to Jesus, he died. And Jesus knew he was dying. We're never okay with losing our loved ones. We're never okay with being sick or being tormented or whatever stuff going wrong. We want to keep our health. We want prosperity on our jobs. We want our kids to be healthy and wealthy and wise. I don't know about you, but I always want my trouble and my discomfort to go away ASAP. Lord, hurry up. But no matter how faithful we are to the church, no matter how much we love God, no matter how often we pray or praise or whatever, you know, no matter how faithful we are to the mission, no matter how often and how sincere we serve God, there are times in each of our lives when our prayers don't get answered the way we want them answered. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. There are times when God doesn't do what we want him to do the way we want him to do it. There are times when we will all have to go through some stuff. Our loved ones leave us sometimes, no matter how close we are to God. I have to remind you today that sometimes God has some other plans on the table that necessitate our going through what we don't want to go through. Remember what Jesus said when they first told him? You see? Now Mary and Martha didn't hear that. Mary and Martha didn't know that. They were expecting Jesus to rush back where they were and lift their brother off the sickbed. But he didn't make it. It may look like and feel like God has forsaken us sometimes. But if we keep the faith, you see, what the devil wants us to do is to get distraught and give up. But until we get to the end, while we are going through, I need to let you know that we have a consolation. God promised. He never promised that we wouldn't have any hardship. Bible says that man born of a woman is but a few days and full of trouble. But he did promise to be with us. He said, no matter what happens, I'll be there with you. God promises to minister to our hearts and give us the grace to not avoid but come through every trial. According to our text, Martha came out to meet Jesus. As soon as she heard that he was there, but Mary remained sitting in the house. I ain't going out there. He's just not getting here. Lazarus dead now. What are you going to do? We're not told any more details, but either Mary didn't hear that Jesus was there, or she was just too upset to see him right then. Either way, Jesus he was left to talk to Martha by himself. So when Martha saw Jesus, she didn't say, "Hello, Lord, how you doing today?" She didn't greet him or hug him or anything close to how she normally greeted him. As soon as she got within an earshot, she blurted, "Lord, if you've been there, my brother wouldn't have died. How come you weren't here to keep my brother from dying? What took you so long? Where were you? What were you doing that was so important that you couldn't come and see about Lazarus? We were depending on you to come, and you didn't. We just knew that you would show up and deliver our brother, but you didn't." All of her hurt and disappointment just, it ever happened to you, just poured out. Is there anybody here beside me who has vented to God? Didn't like the way God let it happen, and you kind of wanted to pray, but your prayer was a vent. When you got close enough to God, you sometimes take the liberty to vent your disappointment. And we don't talk about it, but you ever been disappointed in how God let it go? "Lord, how could you let it happen?" My mother got shot. I vented on God. I fussed at God. Lord, what is this? She was only 42 years old. And you could have protected her. If you'd have let me know, I could have protected her. What are you doing to me, Lord? The message for today is that even when we're lost in it, even when we feel like God has not been there for us, we can't stop our interaction with him. We can't end our prayer with the outpouring of our hurt and our pain and disappointment. Our prayer can't end there. Look at what Martha did. After she expressed her hurt and her disappointment, she pulled her faith up into the conversation. Listen, she said, "But even now, my heart is broken, my brother is dead, but even now, Jesus, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. I'm hurt, but I still got my faith. I'm disappointed. I got my faith. My faith tells me that if you ask something of God, even now, he'll do it for you." It's a real bad day, but even now. I remember when Jesus gave a strong message to people about what he had to go through. You know, we want a salvation that ain't no trouble. And we want every day to be, you know. And when there was some trouble, a lot of the people who were following him left him. And he said to his disciples, "Will you two go away? Huh?" They left him. And one of the disciples asked, he says, "Where else can we go? You're the Savior. You're the pathway to the Father. Even though you're mad with God, even though you feel like you have been let down by God, where else can you go?" You see, I had been out in the world. I know what was out there. And when I was mad with God, I had no place else to go. I may get disappointed sometimes. I may even get mad with God for not doing what I ask him. But God, I'm stuck with him. Because I know that there's no other place under the sun. Jesus' answer was, your brother will rise again. I'm just about done. Martha didn't get it. She said, Lord, I know he's going to rise again in the last day in the resurrection. Then he gave her the revelation, the point of the wait. He said, I am. She didn't know that. She knew that Jesus was a good healer and a good teacher, and that she loved him, and she thought he was a good prophet, you know. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die. Well, she kind of, well, you know, he'll raise you up if you get there soon enough. He'll raise you up if you haven't been dead so long. But when you're dead and you start to deteriorate and your body stinks, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this, Martha? And the point was, Jesus doesn't have to wait for the resurrection. Jesus doesn't have to wait to bless us. Martha didn't know it, but Jesus was using this situation, this sickness, and the later death of her brother as a teaching tool for us. Mary and Martha knew that Jesus had some power, but they didn't know the extent. Jesus wanted them to understand the real picture. Martha, you're talking about the resurrection and what will happen then. I need you to know that I am the resurrection. And he's introducing a whole new level of faith here. Listen, those who believe in me, though they die, they will live. And whoever lives and believes in me, you know, I ain't talking about the latter day. I ain't talking about the day of resurrection. I'm talking about today. I can hear Jesus telling Martha, not only do I have clout, and Glenn and I were talking this morning about this a little bit, not only do I have clout with God, Martha, I am God. I'm going to let that soak in. After Martha understood and accepted her enlightened faith, you know, she went, let me call my sister, you know, and we get this truth of God, we get the love of God, and we know how powerful God is, and we don't tell nobody, we don't tell our sisters, we don't tell our brothers. But Martha wanted Mary to get in on some of this. And our job is not just to be blessed by this word. Our job is to bless others with the same truth. She wanted her sister's faith to be renewed like her faith was. Some of us pull away from God when we don't get what we want from him. But when you're hurt and disenchanted, it's even more important that you get into the presence of God and allow him to speak to your heart. Did you know when you're downhearted and you, God, he has let me vent. And then he lifted my heart. I was mad at God and everybody in the world. And God just let me finish thinking what I wanted to think and saying what I wanted to say. And he says, I'm with you. It may seem like a rough time you're going through right now. You may think that you can't stand it. But he said, I'm with you. Some folk don't think that God really cares about our hurts. But when Jesus saw Mary crying, you know, and this is important. He cried. You don't understand what I'm saying right now. Hallelujah. When Jesus saw Mary crying, when God saw Mary crying, he cried. We don't have a Savior who can't be touched with our cares and our hurts and what we're going through. This lets me know that when I'm hurt, when I got a heavy heart, when I cry, how many of you know that life will leave you with tears sometimes? But we know now that when we cry, Jesus cries with us. When we're going through, Jesus goes through with us. We find ourselves deep in it sometimes. It's my privilege to let you know today that when you belong to God, He's in it with you. I say, when I belong to God, God belongs to me, but He's with me. When they showed Jesus where they buried Lazarus, He went to the site of the grave, and the Bible says the cave, and He was still groaning because He was hurting, because Mary and Martha were hurting. And He ordered those who were there to roll the stone away. And my time is up, but I got to stop. Martha warned Jesus that the body would be stinking by now. But Jesus assured her that His word was true. Sometimes life stinks. But because it stinks, that won't keep God from dealing with our issue. Because it stinks, that won't keep, you know, some of us, if it stinks, we'll push back. Anybody got some stuff that stinks? And when it stinks, nobody else wants to be bothered with it. They don't want to hear about it. But God won't leave you because it stinks. Sometimes we've allowed ourselves and our lives to go so far down that we think there's no longer any hope for us. But it's never too late. I say it's never too late. It's never so far gone that God can't bring it back. It's never so messed up that God can't fix it. It might smell bad now, but even now, Jesus can fix it. So never give up on God. And God won't ever give up on you. Never give up on God. And God won't ever give up on you. Father God, we thank You for sticking with us, even when we stink, for being with us through our hard time and through our heartaches and through our troubled time. I thank You, Lord, for looking over our vents and our anger and our disappointments and still coming through someone here, someone streaming has been going through, someone listening, dear Lord, is angry with You and angry with life and angry with everybody else, feeling like You've forsaken them. Help them to understand right now that you're with them. And in the end, they're still going to win. That if they don't give up on You, that You won't give up on them. Someone who's lost, Father, because their faith has been shaken because of what's happened. Lift it back up right now. Encourage someone who's discouraged. Assure someone, dear Lord, who's lost their faith in You. We thank You for it. We claim the victory, Lord, even in the face of defeat. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God. The doors of the church open. If you're looking for a place to fellowship, we invite you to come. If you've fallen out with God, you want to make up. Now, if you're streaming and you're making a commitment, put it in the chat. Even now, make a commitment to God.
You've always been enough. Though the night may get darker, though the waiting seems long, you have always been faithful to remind me of your love. You are good. In the morning I'll say you are good. In the evening I'll say
I don't know who this is for, but the Lord told me to say, if you want God to commit to you, it's for somebody. If you want God to commit to you, you need to be committing to Him. If you want God to belong to you, you need to belong to Him. Father God, we thank you. We bless you, Father, for your word, for the assurance that we can have even in troubled times. We're disappointed and let down that you're still with us. And now may the grace of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, his Son, may he bless you. And may the love of God and the fellowship of his Spirit stay with you and be with you, Father, from this time that we leave until we come again. Amen.